justices hear a case about whether government funding can be used for religious education. Plus, abuse in the ranks. History is made as a congressional deal takes the reporting of sexual assault out of the military chain of command. And on trial, the police officer who shot Daunte Wright during a traffic stop in a Minneapolis suburb sees her case go to court. All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
economy for 160 years. BNSF, the engine that connects us.
Consumer Cellular. Johnson & Johnson. Financial services firm, Raymond James.
Supporting social entrepreneurs and their solutions to the world's most pressing problems. SkollFoundation.org.
The Lemelson Foundation, committed to improving lives through invention in the U.S. and developing countries. On the web at Lemelson.org. Supported by the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, committed to building a more just, verdant, and peaceful world. More information at macfound.org. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
I'm Stephanie Tsai with NewsHour West. We'll return to the full program after the latest headlines. The fight against COVID-19 is advancing. Pfizer says its double-dose vaccine plus a booster may offer significant protection against the Omicron variant. The initial two doses by themselves appear much less effective. Meanwhile, the FDA authorized a new AstraZeneca antibody drug for people with serious health problems who need more protection. And in other COVID news, late tonight, the Senate voted to overturn President Biden's vaccine mandate for private businesses. The measure now moves to the House of Representatives. We'll turn to the issue of vaccine mandates after the news summary. President Biden today underscored his warnings to Russia's President Vladimir Putin not to invade Ukraine. Leaving the White House, the president said sending in American troops is not on the table, but Moscow would still pay a high price.
Economic consequences like none he's ever seen or ever have been seen. But the idea the United States is going to unilaterally use force to confront Russia invading Ukraine is not in the cards right now.
The president said he is confident that Putin got the message. Germany officially has a new leader. Olaf Scholz became chancellor today, marking the end of Angela Merkel's 16-year tenure. Scholz took office as leader of a progressive coalition of parties. They say they'll focus on modernizing Germany and combating climate change. Canada and Britain are the latest countries to announce diplomatic boycotts of the Winter Olympics in China. Like the U.S., they will not send government officials to the February Games in Beijing, but their athletes will still compete. Canada's Prime Minister Justin Trudeau spoke in Ottawa.
We are extremely concerned by the repeated human rights violations by the Chinese government. That is why we are announcing today that we will not be sending any diplomatic representation to the Beijing Olympic or Paralympic Games this winter.
Australia is also taking part in the boycott. French authorities have released a man they arrested in the murder of Saudi journalist Jamal Khashoggi. They say he was not who they thought he was. Khashoggi had criticized the Saudi crown prince and was killed after entering a Saudi consulate in Turkey in 2018. Back in this country, a father and son have been arrested on suspicion of sparking the giant Caldor fire in California earlier this year. David Scott Smith and his son Travis Shane Smith were booked on reckless arson charges that resulted in great bodily injury to multiple victims. They each are being held on $1 million bail. The Caldor fire leveled the town of Grizzly Flats. It burned more than 200,000 acres in the Lake Tahoe area and was ablaze for more than 2 months. A Minneapolis jury heard opening statements in the manslaughter trial of a former police officer who fatally shot black motorist Dante Wright last April. Prosecutors said Kim Potter betrayed her mission. The defense said she mistook her gun for her taser and that Wright should have surrendered. We'll have details later in the program. A jury in Chicago has begun deliberations on charges that the actor Jussie Smollett faked a hate crime against himself to gain publicity. In closing arguments today, the defense said two men who claim Smollett hired them to stage the attack are liars. The prosecution accused Smollett of lying. The CEO of Instagram called today for creating an industry body dedicated to keeping young people safe online. Adam Mosseri testified at a U.S. Senate hearing amid growing criticism of how Instagram affects the mental health of young users. Democrat Richard Blumenthal questioned how new standards would be policed.
Would the Attorney General of the United States or the Attorney General of a state like Connecticut, where I was Attorney General, have the power to enforce those standards?
Senator, we believe in enforcement. Specifically, how to implement that enforcement is something that we would like to work with your office on and other offices as well.
Well, that's a simple yes or no. Enforceability has to be part of your proposal.
Senator, I agree. Enforceability is incredibly important.
Mosseri would not commit to terminating plans to add a version of the platform for children under 13. That project is now on pause. Former White House Chief of Staff Mark Meadows is suing the Congressional Committee investigating last January's assault on the U.S. Capitol. He says the committee's subpoenas are overly broad. The committee warned today that Meadows will be held in contempt of Congress for refusing to testify. Still to come on the NewsHour, the new U.S. envoy to Afghanistan discusses the worsening humanitarian situation there. We examine the many facets of the debt ceiling debate in Congress. A Tennessee pastor gives his brief but spectacular take on caring for seniors, plus much more.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
The U.S. Senate is set to vote this evening on repealing President Biden's vaccine mandate for businesses with 100 or more employees. The measure, which needs 51 votes, is expected to pass after Democrats Joe Manchin and John Tester announced their support. But the bill faces an uphill battle in the Democrat-controlled House of Representatives, and President Biden is likely to veto it, should it land on his desk. I spoke about this moments ago with Senator John Thune. He is the second highest-ranking Republican in the Senate. Senator John Thune, thank you very much for joining us. Let me just ask you flat out, what is the argument for not having the government require large employers to make sure that their employees are either vaccinated or are tested once a week?
Well, I think several arguments. One is just the impact it would have on the workforce. All of us have heard from employers in our states. I think the number in South Dakota is somewhere on the order of about 30% of workers wouldn't be able to go to work if this vaccine mandate were put into place. And I think the belief that a lot of us have, and I'm pro-vaccine, I'm vaccinated. I encourage people in South Dakota and everywhere else I go to get vaccinated all the time. But I think it's really hard to have a federal government through a regulatory agency impose this kind of a mandate. And I think the courts have already determined that they don't have the constitutional authority to do that. All we're simply doing is putting Congress on the record. And I think tonight we'll have a bipartisan vote in favor of overturning this mandate.
Well, when you know, Senator, I mean, there's more evidence coming in every day. These vaccines are effective. And in fact, there's more evidence today that with a booster, they are very, very effective in preventing COVID. Why wouldn't you want to see everything possible done to see that people don't get this virus and save lives.
Well, and I think that's why we should do everything we can to encourage, persuade, whatever it takes to get people, you know, in a voluntary way to exercise their individual freedom and responsibility to get that done. I honestly think, Judy, that in some respects, mandating this will have the counter effect. I think it's going to push people away who otherwise you might be able to persuade to get this vaccine. I don't think people sometimes understand when you have government in Washington, D.C., issuing requirements and mandates like this, the effect that it has on people who view these issues to be personal issues, in some cases religious issues, in some cases medical issues. And sometimes you can work through that and encourage them and get them vaccinated, but in some cases you can't do that. And I just think that in cases where you can't do that, a lot of these employers, and I know a lot of them, are working really hard to keep their workplaces safe. And by requiring and mandating this vaccine, it's going to cost them a lot of jobs. And I can tell you, and I've talked to employers in South Dakota where, you know, they're talking about 50% reduction in workers as a result of this. And that has a crushing effect on the economy. And in some cases, these are employers that are doing important work, like caring their healthcare workers and people who are caring for people's health.
Well, I did see a report that healthcare companies in South Dakota have resulted in, when they require their employees, something like 97%+ of their employees got the vaccination. I also would point out that there's an option of being tested every week. But I just want to ask the question a different way, because people have been urged to get the vaccine ever since the vaccine came out. You still have people resisting. And it's been pointed out that fewer Republicans, a significant percentage fewer Republican, people who identify as Republicans, are willing to get the vaccine. Does listening to Republican leaders like you and others say mandates are wrong, does that end up discouraging people from getting the vaccine?
You know, I don't think that's true. In fact, like I said, I think mandating it actually discourages the people who we're trying to reach with this. But that being said, the point that you make, there are healthcare providers in South Dakota, but they've done that on their own volition. It hasn't been a federal government mandate. And I respect the right of an individual employer if they decide to do that, a business. I'm not saying you can't do that. I think it's a free country if you want to do that. I just don't think that the federal government ought to be mandating it. And I think we all want to encourage the maximum amount of people to get vaccinated. I think that makes us all safer. And we're seeing good success in our state of South Dakota and across the country. But I think the mandate is something that, and people in rural areas, maybe we're different this way, but, you know, I look at the vote we're going to have today. It's going to be a bipartisan vote. My neighbor from Montana, John Testu, who represents a state not unlike South Dakota, is going to be voting against this mandate as well. And I think it's partly just this perception that people in some states and a lot of people across the country have, that when government, big government, tells you to do something like this, it steps on, infringes on their constitutional rights and freedoms and sense of personal responsibility. So I think there's a better way to do this than the mandate, and I just think that this will have a bipartisan vote tonight to overturn this mandate, but a lot of that, as I said, is already happening in the courts, because I think the courts have also found that this to be unconstitutional.
A different question about all this, and that is about the politics of it. On the one hand, a number of Republicans saying they oppose President Biden, Democrats saying a mandate is a good thing to do. But on the other hand, Republicans saying President Biden is responsible for COVID not being under control. I mean, does that compute?
Well, I don't think, you know, I think there are, in politics, people, both sides are going to try and take advantage of a situation and perhaps, you know, politicize it. I don't think that's what we ought to be doing with an issue like a healthcare crisis. I think we ought to be encouraging people to make the right decisions and giving them the science and the facts and the data and informing them as best we can about what's the best way to protect themselves, their families, their communities. And so I would hope, at least on this, that we could kind of keep the politics out of it. I think that President Trump, you know, to his credit, worked really hard to get a vaccine in place. President President Biden, to his credit, has worked hard to try and get people vaccinated, but I don't think mandating it is going to accomplish that objective. And I think that's it's backfiring on them, I believe. I think that's why you're going to have a bipartisan vote today to overturn it.
Senator John Thune, the second-ranking Republican in the Senate, thank you very much.
Thanks, Judy. Appreciate it.
The Supreme Court grappled once again today with the issue of church and state. As John Yang reports, today's arguments about whether taxpayer funds can be used to pay tuition at religious schools in Maine comes on the heels of recent cases in which the justices sided with religious freedom advocates.
Olivia Carson lives in a Maine town so small that it doesn't have its own high school. In this largely rural state, more than half the school districts don't have high schools. Those districts help pay tuition at state-approved private schools if that's what parents want. Olivia's parents chose Bangor Christian Schools, which both of them had attended as well. Olivia's mother, Amy.
Really good academics, small classroom size, pretty much a family atmosphere. You didn't worry when they went to school.
They also liked what the school describes as a high school curriculum designed from a biblical worldview.
It's the same kind of atmosphere we have at the house. It's the same atmosphere she has at school and the same teachings and the same kind of guidelines and structure.
But that faith-based teaching is also why the state wouldn't allow tuition payments for Olivia, who graduated earlier this year and is now in college. So the Carsons, backed by the Institute for Justice, a libertarian group, sued, saying that violated their First Amendment rights to free exercise of religion.
So you see kids or families that can't afford to send their kids where they really want to send them, that should be able to. To exclude the school solely based on its faith-based academics, it's not right.
Last year, the Supreme Court ruled that a state can't exclude schools from a tax credit-backed scholarship program simply because they're affiliated with a church. In this case, the justices are being asked whether taxpayer money may go to schools providing religious instruction.
The government should not be in the religious sphere.
Tom Cunniff is general counsel for the nation's largest Lutheran denomination, which filed a brief supporting the state of Maine.
Because religious education is fundamentally different, it is appropriate for the state of Maine to say, we do not want to be involved and entangled in religious education.
In today's oral arguments, the ideological differences between some of the justices was evident. Justice Stephen Breyer, a liberal, warned against government choosing among religions.
There are 65 religions or more in this country, and they believe a lot of different things. And what's worrying me is that if the state must give money to the schools, they're going to get into all kinds of religious disputes.
But Justice Samuel Alito, a conservative, suggested that Maine's restriction on sectarian education could do just that. He posed a hypothetical to Maine's lawyer about a religious school teaching non-discrimination and universal respect.
These are principles that we think our students should keep in mind, consistent with the religious outlook of our community. Would that school be disqualified?
I think what the defining feature or what would make the difference is whether children are being taught that your religion demands that you do these things, that your religion
demands.
Then
you really are discriminating on the basis of religious belief.
Today's case is one of three dealing with religious rights. The court is considering this term.
So this is a court that not only is very interested in how religion is being treated, but also feels very strongly that the free exercise clause in particular in the First Amendment should be aggressively enforced or implemented.
Marcia Coyle is chief Washington correspondent for the National Law Journal.
I think the court fell into something of a familiar pattern with these cases. You had the court's conservative majority being very skeptical of the state of Maine's arguments. And then you had the three justices on the liberal wing of the court who feel that, now, wait a minute, this is almost, if we strike down this program and require a state to fund religious schools. That's almost a step too far in terms of what the court has been doing, that there still is separation of church and state.
The justices will deliver their decisions in the three religion cases by the end of June 2022. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm John Yang.
Lawyers presented opening arguments today in the trial of former Minnesota police officer Kim Potter. Last April, she fatally shot Daunte Wright, a 20-year-old black man, during a traffic stop in a Minneapolis suburb. Special correspondent Fred DeSam-Lazaro has this report on the events that led to today's trial. It's part of our ongoing series, Race Matters. And a warning, some of the images in this story are disturbing.
Scream his name!
In downtown Minneapolis last week, protesters rallied for the family of Daunte Wright.
Ain't no justice in this town.
They took to the streets outside the Hennepin County Courthouse as jury selection got underway in the manslaughter trial of Kim Potter.
Kim Potter is a killer cop, and she needs to be imprisoned for a long time. No justice, no peace.
Perhaps underlining the simmering tensions here, a car forced its way through the crowd. No one appeared seriously injured, and the protest went on. The Minneapolis-St. Paul area has been on edge for more than 18 months since the police killing of George Floyd and the unrest that followed. But that anxiety intensified last April in the waning days of Derek Chauvin's murder trial, when Wright was killed during a traffic stop in the Minneapolis suburb of Brooklyn Center. Potter, a veteran of the force, and two other officers pulled Wright over for expired tabs and a hanging air freshener. The officers then discovered Wright had an outstanding warrant, and when they went to arrest him, he tried to get back in his car. The killing set off days of protests outside the Brooklyn Center Police Department. There were clashes between demonstrators and law enforcement, who deployed rubber bullets, flashbangs, and tear gas. Meanwhile, Wright's family grieved publicly.
There's never going to be justice for us. The justice would bring our son home to us, knocking on the door with his big smile, coming in the house. Justice isn't even a word to me. I do want accountability, 100% accountability.
Potter resigned from the department and was later charged with first and second degree manslaughter. During today's opening statements, prosecutors laid out their case.
She was trained to be aware of the differences between her gun and her taser. This case is about an officer who knew not to get it dead wrong, but she failed to get it right.
But Potter's lawyers argued mistakes can occur despite training and that she acted swiftly to protect fellow officers.
Mr. Wright can stop. All he has to do is stop and he'd be with us. But he goes. She can't let him leave because he's going to kill her partner. And so she does taser, and she pulls the trigger, believing that it was a taser.
Potter will take the stand in her own defense.
Some people want the criminal system to speak to really broad issues of justice and morality, and they want the trial to be about, was Kim Potter wrong?
Rachel Moran is a law professor at the University of St. Thomas. She says the trial may be dissatisfying for members of the community clamoring for systemic change.
The trial is going to hinge on, can the state show that she, not that she meant to kill him, but that she disregarded her training, that her act of grabbing the gun instead of the taser was so beyond the pale of what any reasonable officer would do that it could be considered reckless. Those are tough questions actually to answer, and that's where the nuance exists.
In the meantime, officials and residents are grappling over what's next for Brooklyn Center. The killing of Daunte Wright seemed to bring to the surface issues around race and policing that had lurked just below, in a city that rapidly has become Minnesota's most diverse.
I feel
very much personally responsible for what happened with the killing of Dante Wright.
Mike Elliott is the mayor of Brooklyn Center. He's pushed a number of public safety reforms, including using unarmed civilians for certain traffic violations and moving funds from police to mental health specialists and social workers.
When we looked at our 911 call data, we saw only 22% of the calls were criminal or crime related. Almost 80% of the calls were either 43% general call for help, about 11% medical and mental health. We saw that there was a great need for us to have this alternative response system.
But it's been a tough sell for you, hasn't it?
It has. You know, as you know, anything new is a tough sell, right?
After police unions warned the proposal would threaten public safety, the city council this week approved a compromise, taking less money than originally planned from the police department. For now, all eyes are on the courtroom.
I, along with everybody in our community, wants to see justice served. Justice doesn't just, though, mean what happens in the courtroom. It is preventing the kind of conditions that can lead to a Dante Wright being shot and killed.
A plea that Wright's mother, the state's first witness today, has repeated since April. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Fred DeSamlazaro in Brooklyn Center, Minnesota.
It's been nearly 4 months since the United States' withdrawal from Afghanistan, the collapse of the Afghan government, and the Taliban takeover. The country is now widely seen in freefall, with citizens in danger and a spiraling humanitarian crisis. Here's Nick Schifrin.
Afghanistan is on the brink of mass starvation. Every single Afghan province is considered food insecure or even in crisis. 23 million Afghans need food assistance. 8.7 million are nearing famine. 1 million children face acute, severe malnutrition and could starve and die this winter, far more than died in 20 years of war. Schools have no money to pay teachers because the banking system is inoperable. And the healthcare system is near collapse because international assistance that was the source of funding has been frozen. To talk about U.S. policy, I'm joined by Tom West, recently named the U.S. Special Representative for Afghanistan in his first broadcast interview in this role. Tom West, welcome to the NewsHour. The U.S. is providing hundreds of millions of dollars in humanitarian aid, but it's frozen all other assistance and kept in place pre-existing sanctions on the Taliban that have become basically de facto sanctions on the Afghan government. Why?
Nick, thank you for having me. Let me first say that the humanitarian crisis unfolding and worsening in Afghanistan is at the very center of policymaking. You mentioned hundreds of millions. It's $474 million in American humanitarian assistance. That's in addition to $4.1 billion since 2002. We've issued two general licenses that aim to provide for UN organizations, humanitarian actors, NGOs, to really scale up and meet the needs of a coming crisis this winter. Through outreach to particular corporations, we've managed to stitch together an operation that now is trucking in many millions of dollars explicitly to help humanitarian organizations scale up. We talked to the Taliban at great length about the magnitude of Afghanistan's dependence on foreign aid in the many months leading up to their takeover on August 15th. They chose a military takeover. I think they knew the consequences, and they made that decision anyway. And unfortunately, the Afghan people are suffering as a result.
The U.S. made those consequences clear, but today we are witnessing state collapse in real time. The U.N. says that if the trends we've been talking about continue, 97% will be in poverty. That is a level of poverty never seen before in any conflict anywhere. Do you acknowledge that U.S. policy is exacerbating the crisis, even if the U.S. didn't start it?
You know, I'd say that collectively the international community has not yet decided to pursue, for instance, sanctions relief. There are a range of things we want to see from the Taliban when it comes to establishing a record of responsible conduct.
What are you waiting for? What is it exactly that you expect the Taliban to do right now?
So we are not conditioning humanitarian assistance on anything that the Taliban moves forward with. So that $474 million is moving. And I'd add that there are about $1.5 billion stalled at the World Bank, the Afghanistan Reconstruction Trust Fund, that used to support about 75% of public expenditures.
I think, as you know, this is well beyond humanitarian assistance, emergency humanitarian assistance. This is what the government calls humanitarian plus assistance, the idea of a healthcare system, the idea of an education system, the very idea of getting cash into society, people's salaries being paid, without all of which they cannot live. They cannot actually survive throughout the day. Do you acknowledge that this is a question more than morality? It's a question of national security. If the Afghan state collapses, do you acknowledge that you could have a migration crisis that could destabilize the region?
You know, my first stop abroad in this job was to Brussels, where I consulted with our allies. Yes, I think the possibility of a repeat of 2015 and 16 looms very large in their minds. And that is why, you know, on behalf of our allies, I think that is reason enough to do more to mitigate this humanitarian crisis underway.
Let's try and do some specifics and get into the healthcare system. And to do that, I want to show a clip from a hospital in Kabul that my colleague Jane Ferguson filmed just last month.
Son of Saddam, written on a piece of tape stuck to this child's chest, is all that identifies him. With each shallow breath, his chances of making it grow thinner. This ward is packed, frail, sick babies lined up next to one another in beds meant for one. Almost a third don't make it. That means four or five of the babies in this room will die.
What is the U.S. doing to help those children?
Well, like I said, I mean, the urgency of a policy response is underway. But look, Nick, those images are just absolutely heartbreaking for anybody who cares about Afghans. I think as a society, a lot of us in America still care about the Afghan people, about the 38 million people who remain there.
Let's talk about education a little bit. 222,000 teachers. Can the U.S. help pay the salaries? Again, salaries that have not been paid, frankly, for much of the year.
I'd sketch for you maybe two areas of really strong consensus within the international community when it comes to potential support to teachers, again, through the World Bank. One is that we want to see a serious and rigorous academic curriculum. We've received strong assurances from the Taliban that they have no interest in revising the curriculum of the last 20 years. Second, we want to see some quiet efforts to, in effect, monitor and give us confidence that when the Taliban say women and girls are back in school, they tell us back in 12 provinces. We want independent monitors to let us know the same. We've seen positive public statements in this regard from a range of officials with the Taliban, but we want to see follow through and we want to see a monitoring arrangement in place as well.
Is that follow through worth risking the lives of a million children this winter, given that those million children need more than emergency humanitarian aid, they need structural assistance that the U.S. is currently freezing?
So when I say follow through, I mean specifically on education and the matter of salaries. I mean, unfortunately, providing 200,000 teachers their salaries, even that is not going to be enough to truly meaningfully mitigate the suffering underway. I think the scale of the intervention is going to have to be larger.
Tom West, Special Representative for Afghanistan, thank you very much.
Thank you, Nick.
Late last night, the U.S. House of Representatives passed its version of the annual National Defense Authorization Act. The bill, which still needs Senate approval, contains a number of changes to how the military deals with its long-standing problem of sexual assault. But some members of Congress say the reforms don't go far enough and could even exacerbate the problem. Amna Nawaz has more.
Judy, for decades, there's been a debate among military experts and on Capitol Hill about how to improve the way the military investigates and prosecutes allegations of sexual assault in its ranks. One major issue is the role and influence of military commanders in deciding how cases are adjudicated. With me now is New York Democratic Senator Kirsten Gillibrand. Senator Gillibrand, welcome back to the NewsHour. Always good to have you. A lot of folks have been hailing this new legislation, this agreement, as a sea change, a giant leap forward for sexual assault survivors. You've said, yes, it does have some major reforms, but it doesn't go far enough, and you plan to vote against it. Why?
Well, it's a missed opportunity. We had such a groundswell of support to creating an independent prosecutor that functioned outside the chain of command, one who was highly trained and independent with no bias. And unfortunately, the House and the Conference Committee chose to retain enormous amount of authority within the chain of command. The commander is still the convening authority. So at the beginning of every trial, it will say this court-martial has been convened by XYZ commander. The commander continues to retain authority to choose some of the witnesses, to give permission for certain expert testimony, to entirely dismiss someone from the military. So there's a lot of authority that is still in the commander's hands. And so from the perception of a survivor or a plaintiff, I don't think they will believe that this process is independent of their commander, who may well be in their own chain of command or the chain of command of their perpetrator and the person they're accusing of sexual assault.
The commanders did lose some power in this, right? They no longer have the authority to decide if the accused should be prosecuted in the first place. They were stripped of that authority. And now the lead trial counsel, if the cases move forward, reports straight up to the secretary of each military branch, which is a change. There's also a provision for tracking instances of retaliation. Do you think all of those will have any kind of impact?
So all of those changes would seem to be positive. But about a third of service members who are assaulted in the military don't report because they don't believe the chain of command will have their back. In fact, 44% when surveyed said that they would be more likely to report if the decision making was not within the chain of command. So yes, they made some changes. I just don't know if those changes will work because they didn't meet the need of an independent military justice system.
So Senator Gillibrand, what happened? I recall in the summer you were confident that this bill would move forward. You just cited all the support it had. We should note the final text was done by the chairman and ranking members of both the House and Senate Armed Services Committee. So you were not in that room. But what happened? How did it get removed?
Senator Jack Reed and his ranking member, as well as Congressman Adam Smith and his ranking member, chose in conference to take it out. It did pass in the Senate Armed Services Committee, the entire provision, and we thought it did have sufficient support. But these four men have enormous power, and behind closed doors, they chose to put their will in front of the will of all those members of Congress. The other reform they chose not to take is a bright line at all serious crimes that are non-military. Our bill, for example, had 38 crimes removed from the chain of command. This bill chose to remove 11. It didn't remove assault and it didn't remove child abuse, things that clearly should have been removed from the chain of command because a lot of crimes can be shoved right under those two crimes. When you have just a small number of crimes being removed and given to a special prosecutor, you run the risk that service members will see this as special treatment, particularly for crimes that disproportionately affect women. Women are marginalized enough in the armed services. We don't want them to be seen as getting special treatment and further marginalized. We call that a pink court. And that's why we had recommended a bright line at the serious crimes, the one that held more than a year or more of punishment, excluding the military crimes.
Senator, I need to ask you about these reports that there were top military lawyers and even Secretary of Defense Austin himself lobbying members of Congress against your expansive legislation. Is that true? And why do you think they would do that?
Well, I'm well aware that Secretary of Defense Austin was calling around, including calling the majority leader and others that to be heard. And that's obviously his right. But everyone who serves in the military knows the convening authority is determinant for the projection of power in these cases. And so service members know that if the convening authority is still the commander, that the commander holds enormous weight in the outcome of these cases.
That is Democratic Senator from New York, Kirsten Gillibrand, joining us tonight. Senator, thank you so much for your time.
Yes.
And for a different perspective now, we turn to Rhode Island Democrat Jack Reed. He is chairman of the Senate Armed Services Committee. Mr. Chairman, welcome back to the NewsHour. Always good to have you here. You just heard Senator Gillibrand there talk about the broad support her more expansive reforms had. 66 senators, 220 members of Congress, veterans organizations, attorneys general around the country. They wanted those more broad reforms. So why did you cut them out of the bill?
Well, we actually expanded the reforms that the House had proposed. And indeed, the House did not consider Senator Gillibrand's legislation either in the committee or on the floor. So what we managed to accomplish in the conference was to expand and include crimes that are not specifically related to sexual behavior. So it's no longer a pink court. And indeed, it offers the possibility of further changes to expanding that list. So we have, I think, gone a long way to recognize the problem. And this is a problem that has been undercutting our military for years. The expectation, the hope was that there could be a military solution, but I think we need it, and I would commend Congresswoman Spears and Senator Gillibrand, Senator Ernst for what they've done. And also, I've had the opportunity to go down to Fort Hood, talk to individual soldiers, female soldiers especially, get a sense of what they need and to restore trust. And this legislation will do that, and do it in a way that will provide fair justice.
Well, Mr. Chairman, if I may, let me just ask you about some of the specifics in here, because many will argue that it does not go far enough, that you may have created a separate system for some crimes, but that this military commander still has enormous authority and influence over how sexual assault cases are prosecuted. I just want to tick through some of the details real quick, because military commanders in this system still retain the authority to convene trials, to choose jury members, to grant immunity to witnesses, to approve witnesses, and defense experts. So why should military commanders retain that kind of power?
The military commanders have the authority as the convening authority to select a jury pool. Just as in civilian courts, the selection of individual jurors is the choice of the defense lawyer, the special trial lawyer, the prosecutor, and the judge. In fact, under Senator Gillibrand's proposal, it would be solely the authority of the prosecutor to pick the jury. And that, I think, would raise serious constitutional questions and due process questions about fairness.
Well, I think, if I may, her case that she makes is that would be an independent prosecutor rather than a commander who has a connection to both usually the accused and the accuser.
I don't know if there's any civilian court in the world in which the district attorney or the federal attorney gets to pick the jury, because they have an incentive to pick people who will be on their side. I think what we want is fairness. And what we've achieved by allowing the convening authority to establish the pool, not to select the jurors, but to establish the pool, we give the opportunity for the judge, the prosecutor, and the defense lawyer to exercise jury selection through a series of challenges for cause or preemptive challenges. That's the way it's done in every court in America. And to turn it over to the prosecutor, I don't think it would be accepted by any civil authority.
Well, let me ask you about how this is being received, because there have been some former military lawyers who have said there's really no way a prosecutor can be independent in this system, that the military commanders would still exert enormous influence. And survivors groups have a real problem with this. They say it does not go far enough, and it feeds the mistrust that everyone agrees exists in the system. The service members do not feel comfortable that offenders will be held accountable in this system. So I guess my question to you is what your message to those survivors would be, especially the military members who don't believe that this goes far enough?
Well, all I can say is the most prominent group who supports reforms, Protect Our Defenders, has called this the most transformative legislation in the history of the military justice system. So we have made extraordinary strides. We have signaled to all of the men and women of the armed forces that we have heard them, that we are creating a system in which the special prosecutor will have the sole right, not the commander, to prefer these charges. They can't be overruled by a commander. We have these troops, and that's not only a basic tenet of human behavior, but it's also the glue which holds combat units together. Individual responsibility and an individual sense of protecting your subordinates, protecting your comrades. That's what we're striving for, and I think we'll achieve it.
That is Senator Jack Reed, Democrat from Rhode Island, chairman of the Senate Armed Services Committee, joining us tonight. Mr. Chairman, thank you for your time.
Thank you very much.
As Congress is in its final weeks in session for this year, U.S. senators are deciding how they will vote on a deal to raise the debt ceiling after the House passed the first piece of the plan last night. Leaders in both parties are projecting confidence, but the stakes are high. Our Lisa Desjardins helps us understand why the debt limit has become so political and what exactly it does.
The debt part is easy. The U.S. government is the largest spender in the world. Everything from the military and Social Security benefits to school lunches, and even feeding animals at the National Zoo. But the U.S. spends more money than it takes in, a lot more. For most of the past 100 years, we've operated off red ink. All of that government spending, salaries, agencies, weapons, parks, and zoos, it's funded in good part by debt. The debt limit, or ceiling, cuts off how much government can borrow at any time. But U.S. spending is already in motion. Planes have been ordered, government jobs in place. So the debt ceiling doesn't mean our debt or bills will stop. It only stops the U.S. ability to borrow right now and to pay for those bills. Where they would get rid of someone who's testified about our debt, Maya McGinnis of the Committee for a Responsible Federal Budget, explains.
But the purpose of the debt ceiling, I believe, is to make sure that we aren't borrowing unlimited amounts, but instead we have a check and we consider, are we borrowing the right amount of money and are we borrowing for the right things?
When first introduced in 1917 under President Woodrow Wilson, the overall U.S. debt limit was set far above government spending needs. It left room. But now, the debt limit is routinely set at or near what we spend. So Congress, both parties, has to lift the debt ceiling regularly, like in the agreement this week.
We've cleared the path, hopefully, for addressing the debt limit.
Or 2 years ago.
We think it was the best possible deal under the circumstances.
To address the debt ceiling, Congress has two options. They can either raise the debt limit by setting a new dollar figure for total borrowing, or they can suspend it by just punting the problem to a future date. But what happens if the U.S. hits the debt limit and defaults, can't pay its bills? That's never happened, so this is uncharted. But it's likely a financial disaster. To help understand, think of the U.S. government as the world's largest airport. Planes, like money, come in and planes go out. Think of borrowing as what powers the airport. Freeze the borrowing, and that cuts main power to the airport, so most air traffic stops. Now imagine this happened to every U.S. airport. The travel or financial problems would ripple across the world in profound ways.
That amount of uncertainty thrown into the economy, thrown into the country when we've never had it before, could easily push us back into a recession.
The dollar and U.S. Treasury debt bonds are a cornerstone of global trade. Money flies in and out constantly. So if the U.S. can't take on debt and can't pay its bills, it would affect interest rates and stock markets around the world. And here, it also could quickly affect things like mortgages, car payments. Again, it's not entirely clear, including to those in the business.
I put little faith in my ability to predict what would happen in something like this, other than volatility. And markets don't like volatility, so I know it would be incredibly negative.
For government agencies, there would be some kind of a shutdown, and one worse than usual, because so-called mandatory programs like Social Security, usually protected in shutdowns, could see funding cut or frozen. The Treasury Department would ration out where the nation's limited cash goes. So why hasn't Congress just raised the debt ceiling? For one, we are at historic levels of red ink. Only World War II was higher. And for lawmakers, there is both real concern and political maneuvering over that.
We always know the debt ceiling is ultimately going to be raised. The question is, how much of a political game of chicken will we have to go through?
The issue is this. We are in a time of gridlock, close margins, sharp divide, and big spending. The must-pass debt ceiling has become a piece of political leverage and policy warfare. In other words, the debt limit, which was aimed at financial stability, now threatens the opposite. And it largely serves as a mirror of our political instability. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Lisa Desjardins.
Terrell Scruggs is a Tennessee native with a strong sense of his life's calling. He's a preacher and caregiver, providing services to seniors in his Nashville community, even throughout the pandemic. Tonight, he gives his brief but spectacular take on living a life of service.
Caregiving is not a job. You do a job to make something for yourself. But caregiving, you have to give something back from within yourself. My mother and my father raised us to be good Samaritans. We don't look at color, we don't look at wealth, we don't look at money, we look at the individual person. And if we can help them, we do. I was raised in church, about church. I breathe church, I live church. We are religious by choice, and we teach folks how to treat one another as human beings. Not because of what you have or what you own or what you possess. It's just who you are. At 15 years old, I prayed to God that if he ever give me a brother, I would take care of him for the rest of my life. I was 20 years old when I found out that I had a brother. And when I went to visit my biological father, he introduced me to him. And from then on, I decided that I wanted to be a part of his life. My brother is highly challenged. He does not speak. He does not chew. And I told my father that whatever you need, let me know. And I will help you with him. Later on in the year, my biological father passed. And we found his mother a couple of years later on the kitchen floor. Aneurysm. So her daughter took her with her to another county and took care of her, and I took my brother with me. That's how I got him. So that's why I took him in. And it's been lovely ever since. He lived better with me than he did with them because they was ashamed of him. I'm not ashamed of him. I don't go nowhere that he cannot go. Caregiving is a calling. You have to want to help somebody. You have to look beyond yourself, your problems, your disposition in life, and see that you can lend a helping hand. I'm in my second church, and I've been there for 16 years. If you want to help somebody, you can start with the person next door to you. We all in this together. This pandemic has brought us together one way or another. The people that you can help, please help. Even if it's just taking out their trash to the curb so the trash man can come by and pick it up where they can. It's just simple stuff that you can do. It don't cost nothing but a little bit of your time. It ain't what you do for yourself that's gonna last. It's what you do for others. My name is Terrell Scruggs, and this is my brief but spectacular take on helping people.
Thank you, Terrell Scruggs, and we all need to remember that message. And you can watch all of our brief but spectacular episodes at pbs.org/newshour/brief. On the NewsHour online right now, medical historian Howard Markel shares an excerpt from his new book, The Secret of Life, which explores the story of Rosalind Franklin. The female scientist was key to the discovery of the DNA double helix, but was left out of the history for years. You can read that on our website, pbs.org/newshour. And that's the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Judy Woodruff. Join us online and again here tomorrow evening. For all of us at the PBS NewsHour, thank you. Please stay safe, and we'll see you soon.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by For 25 years, Consumer Cellular's goal has been to provide wireless service that helps people communicate and connect. We offer a variety of no-contract plans, and our U.S.-based customer service team can help find one that fits you. To learn more, visit consumercellular.tv.
Johnson & Johnson. BNSF Railway. Financial services firm, Raymond James. The Ford Foundation, working with visionaries on the front lines of social change worldwide. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you. This is PBS News Hour West. From WETA studios in Washington and from our bureau at the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
PBS.